This episode is brought to you by That Gosh Darn Hippie Show. Featuring music from the days of vinyl, it's the grooviest thing to hear on your radio. Here's a question I don't think gets asked often enough. Is the moral ambiguity in Rent a bug or a feature? Are we supposed to ignore the fact that these characters are frequently self-absorbed and irresponsible? Or do we acknowledge that while understanding that, in the face of things like gentrification and government inaction during the AIDS crisis, their traditional social contracts aren't all that appealing? I'm not sure I have an answer, and Jonathan Larson certainly didn't provide one, but I think going back through Rent's lineage gives us a pretty good idea of why it exists. So let's have a look at the 1896 opera La Boheme by Giacamo Puccini. Puccini's tale of love and death in the Latin Quarter of Paris, easily one of the most famous and perennially popular operas of all time, is itself an adaptation. The original source is Henri Murger's Scènes de la Vie de Bohème, a series of short stories published in serial form between 1845 and 1849, and as a collection in 1851. We'll be focusing mainly on the Puccini opera because, as will soon become apparent, it's the source Larson drew most directly from, but put a pin in Murger because we'll be coming back to him later. So here's how it originally went down. It's a bitterly cold Christmas Eve in the Latin Quarter when we meet the four Bohemians: Rodolfo, a poet, Marcello, a painter, Colline, a philosopher, and Schaunard, a musician. Schaunard has just completed a commission and has come into a little money and proposes a night on the town. After successfully evading their landlord Benoit's demand for rent, three of the four young men leave. Rodolfo stays behind to finish some work and is available to answer the door when Mimi, a seamstress who lives in the neighboring garret, comes by to ask for a match for her candle. This being opera, the two pretty quickly fall in love and join Rodolfo's friends at the Café Momus, where they encounter Marcello's ex, the tempestuous singer Musetta, currently enduring the attentions of a stodgy politician named Alcindoro. Musetta's singing wins over the reluctant Marcello, and she ditches her elderly paramour to join the Bohemians, sticking Alcindoro with both their bills. But a couple months pass, and Marcello and Musetta are fighting again, and Rodolfo is making jealous accusations of Mimi. Rodolfo reveals to Marcello that Mimi is deathly ill, and he's pushing her away because he's unable to provide for her. Mimi overhears this and bids Rodolfo farewell, but the couple agree to stay together through the winter. Months pass, and both Musetta and Mimi have found wealthy patrons, and Marcello and Rodolfo are pretending very hard not to care. But Musetta comes to the garret with Mimi, who has left the Viscount who was providing for her and is at death's door. The Bohemians muster their meager resources to obtain medicine and warmth for Mimi, but it's all in vain as she passes away and Rodolfo calls her name in despair. Jonathan Larson obviously stuck pretty close to Puccini's blueprint when writing Rent. Most of the characters are one-to-one translations from La Boheme, with the exceptions of Joanne, who is a combination of Alcindoro's stuffiness and Marcello's on-again-off-again relationship with Musetta, and Benny, who has a more expanded role as both a landlord and former colleague, and also steps in for the Viscount, whose attentions to Mimi spark Rodolfo's jealousy. Puccini's music and narrative cues are also heavily referenced. Roger's guitar motif, being drawn from Musetta's aria, Quando Men Vo, is the most obvious, so much so that a lampshade is hung on it, but a more subtle reference to the same aria occurs in the second act. Listen to the translation of Musetta's first lines. When I walk out alone along the street, people stop and stare at me. They seek out my beauty from head to foot. If that sounds familiar, it's probably because you remember Maureen's verse in Take Me or Leave Me. Likewise, Roger and Mimi's first meeting follows similar beats to that of their Victorian counterparts. The main difference is Boheme Mimi misplaces the key to her apartment, while Rent Mimi loses her heroin stash. But Larson's musical echoes the Puccini opera in an even more significant way, the romanticizing of its source material. If the starving artists of Puccini's La Boheme, and, by extension, Larson's Rent, come off as pretentious, even hypocritical posers, it's probably because the original novel had a rather less idealized view of the Latin Quarter's artistic community. Murger's Bohemians are bourgeois dilettantes, nominally pursuing artistic endeavors, but mostly screwing around and sowing their wild oats until the time comes for them to settle down in middle-class respectability, kind of the Victorian equivalent of taking a gap year to backpack through Europe. Women like Musetta and Mimi were not grand romances for the ages, but brief flings to be set aside in favor of a proper wife. Ironically, both Puccini and Larson are guilty of the same thing as Murger's protagonists, treating poverty as a lifestyle choice rather than a crippling condition. Which says something about the way we tend to treat the subject in art. For a medium that, like opera, sells itself so much to the wealthier classes, music theater is fascinated with stories of poverty and social rebellion, from Les Miserables to Hamilton, from Porgy and Bess to Hadestown to Rent. The genre is filled with brave underdogs and status quo shaking protagonists singing their hearts out to people who paid several hundred bucks a pop for the privilege. Is it an elaborate form of virtue signaling, an attempt to package disruptive social elements in a more comfortable form, a disconnect in perspective and experience between the creator and the viewer? Another discussion that isn't brought up near enough, I think.
Ah, but I was so much older.